versus INTZ. Gangplank ban already on the board.
Not again. Never again.
Thank you, Saigon Jokers. One. Oh, and a karma ban. Trying to take that away from Warzone. I like the way this is going. Clearly, these teams have been doing their research, studying, taking things away. NAR also off the board. And I will say this about Saigon Jokers, Fedius.
Yes.
They are ridiculously aggressive, even when they're in a deficit, and I like that.
Well, you heard INTZ earlier on in the day say, hey, we figured out yesterday that if we just play aggressive, then it will work out in our favor. And it seems to have worked out for them earlier on in the day, so they just want to maintain that momentum. But these bans, they're coming out pretty thick and fast.
Yeah. Got the Sivir and Karma taken off the board, trying to limit the mobility on the side of Saigon Jokers. Also the potential for 4 or 5 item carries.
So thinking of what else you could ban away if you're INTZ, looking at the Saigon Jokers, they've put a lot of priority on things like the Alistar, also the Echo up in the top lane, 3 games for the top lane at Row, but it looks like that they're going to keep priorities in the mid lane.
Taking their time here. Talia, of course, a general power pick, but Vladimir is left open, as is Malzahar. Ryze and Cassidy in 2 picks we don't see prioritized at all that have been rather
Shen
popular.
As well. There is a lot open. The Rek'Sai, I feel, has to be the priority for Saigon Jokers. They've played a number of different junglers, Gragas and Rek'Sai being the priority for them. But it looks like you are on the prediction line right now. Those 2 50-minute games, really getting
this,
your juices flowing.
I've done enough play-by-play for the day. It is your turn. No, but this is interesting, of course, when we look at the jungle pool, completely wide open. So instead, I guess, opting to go for the mid lane pick, as it is a more limited pool at this point in time.
Yeah, it definitely makes sense. But the Malzahar and the Kassadin are available right now. You could also look to put something like the Echo in the mid lane. Not the best into the Vladimir, but something that we have seen come out throughout this tournament. And looking back at some of the things that INTZ have played in the mid, the Malz, Kassadin, Cassiopeia, Karma, literally a different mid laner in every single game. So perhaps they'll surprise us, but they don't need to look to prioritize that right now. They can look to pick up their top laner, they can look to pick up their jungler. Surprises me that they wouldn't put that much value on the Rek'Sai given as to how strong she is on the current patch.
Interesting priority. Of course, Revolta now going to lock in the Elise. Not going to be that early Rek'Sai priority or that Gragas, but I think this has been a good pick for Revolta. The early aggression does very much suit him.
Yeah. I mean, it fits into their playstyle of being able to snowball themselves an early lead. And with the Shen, what you want to now do is try and set yourself up for a strong bottom lane. Because if you can get that good push, you can set up for very easy dives with the Elise and the Shen. So Saigon Jokers, they have quite a wealth of options available to them right now, given that you could look to pick up your jungler as well, or you could look to pick up your bottom lane.
Trying to figure out if they want to hide picks or secure something with a little bit higher priority, but they have locked in the Bard already. That will give them some decent power in the early lane, of course. The Meep Slap, truly terrifying in the early levels, and the reliable range of Bard, something to consider.
With INTZ already banning the Karma out themselves, it somewhat limits the options for INTZ to set themselves up for a powerful bottom lane. You could consider something like the Nami, or maybe even the Soraka as well, but we're yet to see things like that coming out from INTZ. They've actually recently been putting a lot of value on the Bard themselves, so Saigon Jokers picking that away from them, yet we have not yet seen this come out from Su throughout the tournament. So we'll have to see how he does moving forward.
Revolta, you can see the vocal member on the team as they go through, trying to figure out what they want for this second rotation. They're going to have to show something here, and what are they going to hold on to for last
pick?
It
has to be the bottom lane. Ashe would make a lot of sense. They've put a lot of value on it in the past, as well as the Jhin, and it will set yourself up for a powerful bottom lane. You could pair that up with the Tahm Kench, which would give you a fairly reliable bottom lane, and would mitigate a lot of the pick potential the Bard does have. You also provide a bit of additional peel for your AD carry, but you could go for something like the Braum as well, which is very safe. But I feel like you have a lot of options because you can already tell what's going in the mid lane for Saigon Jokers. But I feel like saving your mid for the later pick would just make more sense so you could see the rest of the comp.
Well, instead, INTZ are going to save their support pick as they have locked in the Malzahar for talkers. Now, this is a trend that we saw start to emerge in Europe. The power of supports on the current patch is, they're all very impactful. You got Braum, you've got Taric, a lot changed the way that you play the team fights. Tahm Kench as well. All of the powerhouse melee supports up and available. Have to see where INTZ want to take this draft and what Saigon Jokers are going to bring to the table here. They need an AD carry. They're going to need a top laner. Or they're going to need to get creative with the Vladimir.
Well, Saigon Jokers, as you rightly said, I imagine the top laner and the AD carry are going to come out next. Echo would make the most sense, something that they've often fallen back to. Ro has had some very solid performances on the champion. And for the AD carry, we've seen very strong performances from Celebrity on things like the Ezreal and the Lucian, which would definitely give you a powerhouse bottom lane, which is definitely what they're aiming for with the Bard.
Well, powerhouse bottom lane, they're still going to find it, although it won't be the Ezreal or the Lucian this time around. It's going to be the long-range harass of Caitlyn, locked in for Celebrity alongside the Poppy top lane. Sorry, not Poppy support.
So I got the composition of Saigon completely off. I have not predicted a single pick for them yet. And it's definitely them going off the rails a little bit. Perhaps they're picking Comfort. Perhaps they're just going with the flow and picking whatever they see. But for Celebrity, this is now his sixth different AD carry in the tournament. He has played a different champion every single game. and to be honest, it's the same for the mid laner. Going back to the Vladimir as well, we're yet to see a Poppy in this tournament. So I think Saigon are definitely just bringing out what is definitely an interesting composition.
I'm at a loss for words here. I'm excited to see where this Poppy goes, how much of an impact it's going to have. Caitlyn, a little bit weak in the mid game, but can be that late game powerhouse if given the opportunity. And INTZ mulling over this final pick. It will, in the end, be the Braum for Jockster on the bottom side. Braum, Ashe, a solid early lane, but may fall victim to this early Caitlyn Bard lane.
Now, with the something that we've seen a lot from Saigon is the lane swap recently. But I imagine that when you have a Caitlyn Bard, it is very much likely going to go into the 2v2. You have the range advantage. You can definitely be aggressive, but you have to concentrate on getting the early shove and then using a range advantage to poke and zone underneath the turret.
And of course, traps would make that much easier. Saigon, the only team we've seen on this patch lane swap.
Yeah, like in any region. Definitely a unique strategy to Saigon Jokers. Nearly worked out for them in the game before.
And to be fair, if they had a few more wins, we could call them innovators.
Yeah.
But that is not the case. However, our featured matchup for this game has to be Warzone versus Talkers. Talkers consistently touted as one of the weaker points of the INTZ lineup in Warzone. I mean, aptly named.
Yeah.
Wherever Warzone goes, someone is dying. Might be Warzone.
Might be Warzone. That's what I was thinking. Like, this could also be the man himself. But I expect to see another bloodbath. Something that I know you're riveted for. Not the slow game for you, Sifa. Action.
Look, man, I wouldn't care. I really want like a Jhin Air Green Wings versus also Jhin Air Green Wings. I want like a
I talk for 80% of the game.
Like, yeah, for like 80 minutes, and then there's one team fight that ends the game. Yeah, that's what I want. We're going to have a lot of blood. It's going to be an exciting game to end out the day here. Day 5 of the International Wildcard Qualifier. Saigon Jokers on the blue side, and on the opposite side, INTZ looking to cement themselves at the top of the table, looking to secure a higher seed as they head into the semifinals.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, Saigon Jokers, the biggest issue that they have with their composition is the severe lack of crowd control. When you actually look across the board, there is very little, but we won't have time for that as Saigon going very aggressive already.
Jockster taking a bit of damage here. No way to stop him from running away, unfortunately. But starting with the aggressive abilities there coming in from Caitlyn. Not going for the traps in the early game. Of course, wants the little bit of damage.
Looking to get a bit of deep vision down, largely because they are running with the range support. Now, this is often something that you will see when you have a Caitlyn Bard lane. You don't really want to look to take the Krogs. You can, but it's much better to just interrupt INTZ, setting up for that early Gromp, getting that early level 2. You get a bit of damage down, then you can rotate yourself around to the lane, get the early push, and then you can set up for zoning your opponents away and just using the powerful duo lane that you have to your advantage.
Mm. Talkers is AFK.
Oops.
A brief time spent AFK. He'll heal that health up, no problem.
Ooh, interesting.
Strength of the Ages coming in for the Vladimir.
Yeah, now, this is something that we've seen a couple times in the past during the early iterations of Vlad as we see a very cheeky strat coming out from Saigon. They think that they're getting the cheese off by interrupting the Gromp, but in reality, INTZ have already moved down into the lane. And this means that they will definitely be able to set up the lane in which they want it. But Saigon Jokers Looks like they're going to be starting on the bottom side of INTZ's jungle.
Go INTZ appears to be the public perception. 93-7, an immense amount of one-sided votes. Celebrity goows a little wide with the Piltover Peacemaker.
See, the problem with this play is the early push will now go in favor of the Ash Brawn, which means that they're going to be able to get themselves the early two, and we'll have a lot more pressure in the laning phase. So we'll have to see how this lane transpires moving forward, because Macau consistently been one of the strongest performers of INTZ, from my perspective, and I feel that if you're already going to give him an early edge in this laning phase, it's definitely a position that INTZ want to be in.
Bro, winning out in these top lane trades, of course, Poppy does pretty well against the tanks. Did fall out of favor due to a large number of nerfs onto her damage, and Jockster...
That's not good. That is not good if you are the Greys. Revolta now, he wants to add insult to injury. Level 3 to level 2.
Double buff coming in. Revolta just doesn't care. Walking forward, this is great for INTZ. An excellent start to this game. Already putting the jungler down. We look back at Hanyan's last Rek'Sai performance. He was pivotal to getting Saigon back in the game, and they've now limited his ability to impact the map.
And look at this, Jockster. He was only able to get that invade again because of this early push, and Shen gets first blood up in the top lane. We were expecting Action Seifer, and it feels like they were already going to get it.
I like the way that these observers observe. Just surprise. They want to keep us on the edge of our seats. They want us to never be 100%.
We're likely going to get ourselves a replay, but what I imagine happened is that Yang used his teleport as Ro was getting an early push, baited him underneath the turret, he's seen all in the bottom.
Here comes the red buff Braum. Flash forward, Revolta's on the way in too. Celebrity is in trouble, is going to get stunned up. Chain CC coming in, TP's coming in as well, but Celebrity is now set to fall. Ro keeps the ball rolling here, however, looking to take down Macau, but Jockster Revolta just going to back off. Sue gets the double stun, and INTZ pick up their second kill of the game. 1k gold in the lead, only 4 minutes in.
Well, the aggressive duo lane of Saigon Jokers gets heavily punished, but we're not going to have enough time for that, because we are going to get the replay as Ro goes for a level 3 dive against the Shen. Ladies and gentlemen, if you ever wanted a clip of what not to do, that would be it.
I mean, you just literally you just push a W and it stops him from dashing into you.
Yeah. Yes, you do, Seifer.
Frustration on the side of Saigon Jokers, maybe taking a toll.
Ro just wants to be the playmaker. He wants to get an edge over his lane.
Very evident, and it's unfortunate for them because it is not working out currently. Hanyan trying to get back a little bit of the CS that he's missing out on. Saigon Jokers need to make an impact here. Chiefs fans, hold out hope.
They've got the late game. But still, in the early game, if we just look at the gold difference, it is 1,000, largely due to the two kills that have gone over to INTZ, and it's really been made worse after the fact that Ro did teleport down to the bottom half of the map, and now you can just see a massive CS differential developing between the two top laners. And Seifer, something clearly caught your eye.
You can already see the massive CS differential in the mid lane. I think it's good that we bring up the CS Warzone with a massive lead, and I think that is going to be a big winning point for them moving forward, because even as the wave crashes in, you know, it's good to have that that Vladimir with a lead.
Yeah, which is promising, given that Warzone, we talked about how he likes to get involved in these fights, and if he's already getting himself a lead early on, then it's going to set him up nicely for the mid games. Jockster looking for a bit of aggression.
Jockster going to get the stun onto Celebrity. Sue taking a lot of damage. They're just going to keep the ball rolling here. Sue trying to make his way out. Needs to find the stun. Three stacks. Maybe looking for the fourth. Macau moving forward. Gets the last auto attack. Samyon is here. Maybe they can turn it. Graves flash forward. That's some good damage. Macau burning the heal to make it out. Jockster leaping back to safety.
Honestly, feel like that was a bit of a misplay from Jockster. He was prioritizing the Caitlyn, trying to land another Q, trying to just zone him away from the fight, when if he just turned his attention over to Sue, they could have very easily forced the flash out, maybe even the ignite, or better yet, they could have considered getting a kill. But instead, they're just going to force them back. The heal will end up being burnt from Macau. So overall, actually, net loss for the bottom lane of INTZ. But in terms of map control, you can see that Revolta using the knowledge that the jungler is in the bottom lane to get a bit of deep vision down and steal away some of these camps.
Yeah, but still at a deficit in terms of jungle farm. Samyon, 35-24, a pretty decent lead for him. And the lead in the mid lane looking pretty good as well. So all the early game plays were pretty rough for Saigon Chokers. Things are looking a little bit better in terms of CS.
See, a large reason as to why this mid lane advantage had been accrued for Warzone is because early game, it's very difficult for the Malzahar to be able to outpush the Vladimir, because you have very high mana costs and you have a very small mana pool, which means that if you burn all of your mana on trying to trade back with the Vladimir, it will inhibit your ability to actually push the lane out. Whereas if you invest all of your mana into trying to push the wave out, then the Vladimir is just going to constantly trade with you, and he's not going to take any damage in return, which means that you'll end up getting forced out of lane. And what you'll see a lot of Malzahars do is actually run the teleport so that they can just prioritize on pushing, take all the damage, and then at level 4, level 5, go back to base, TP back to lane, and with boots, health pots, and an extra Doran's Ring, the lane will then start to swing back in your favor. But that's... given that he did run the Ghost, this is why you're seeing this big CS differential.
And it's starting to shrink in defense of Talkers. He is doing a decent job on catching back up. And while the mid lane, the jungle, and the AD carry slot look pretty good for the Saigon Chokers, top lane looks grim. The over-aggression from Ro in that early play now leading to that 30 CS differential.
Very surprising that INTZ is actually behind in the bottom lane, given as to their fantastic start. The fact that the lane was pushing in their favor, Caitlyn was forced to go back to base because of her death, should have really netted them an advantage, but as of yet, nothing really significant. Pickaxe being picked up from Macau, whereas the BS sword now just completed for Celebrity is actually not that bad for Saigon Chokers.
Yeah, of course, Macau, when he backs, should be able to buy something. Revolta not looking to let them back anytime soon as he starts to pressure in. Good vision coming in from the Saigon Chokers. Warzone maybe looking for an opportunity to turn this fight in their favor.
Remember that INTZ do have the Shen. So setting up for these dives is something that we talked about during Champion Select. If you can get a good setup in your bottom lane, push underneath the enemy turret, then the Elise is really good.
Celebrity in trouble, but Revolta could be the one to get turned on. Shen ult coming in, arrow coming in as well. Celebrity flashes backwards, just barely able to make it out. Yang giving us pressure on the top side. Poppy making her presence known on the bottom. This could be the fight to turn it in the favor of Saigon Chokers. Knocked out of the fight. Ro looking for a little bit more. Talker's trying to dish out some damage, but Warzone flashes forward. He's on the front lines, but he's exhausted. Trying to get something back soon. Not Ro! Even level Ro! 6. Ro! He's trying to fight the Voidlings. Ah! They're gonna get him! Oh! Warzone getting taken down too, and the vision spreads. Now moving forward for a bit more. Alt comes in. INTZ, they wanted to play more aggressive, and here is that aggression. In comes the ace in the hole. Bot gonna get body blocked out. INTZ, it looks so grim for a moment there, but they're taking control. Sue, next on the menu, is gonna portal through, is not gonna be able to make it out. Double kill coming in the mid lane. The flash taunt finally comes in. Celebrity going to drop, and that is the unofficial ace 9 minutes into the game.
The blueberry pie doing so much work, being thrown into the face of Saigon Chokers, netting Talkers 3 kills in that whole exchange. I'm sorry, Chief fans, if you were hoping for a Saigon turnaround, things are looking bleak right now as INTZ pick themselves up an ace 10 minutes into the game.
And that is a 10-minute 4K gold lead, Vettius. It feels almost insurmountable. Saigon, though, they've never been afraid to pick a fight, and while that time it didn't work out for them, maybe they'll find a different opportunity as Warzone pushes in the mid lane, but a completed entire Morrel Anomicon is picked up by Talkers.
Oh, man. If you thought those blueberry pies hurt before, well, now add a bit of no. magic, a bit of special ingredients from your recipe book, and now they're just going to be doing all the more damage.
No one I know, or anyone ever, as far as I know, has ever referred to Malefic Visions as blueberry pie.
It's a blueberry pie to the face. And then you have your recipe book, you add a couple special ingredients, and then bang! It really packs a punch. But here's the replay as to how all this action started. Celebrity took a huge amount of damage. Revolta got the Shen ult a little bit late, in all honesty. They knew the play was coming, and they should have set up for it sooner. But we don't have time for that because we've got another fight.
Oh, Josh, they're getting aggressive. Chain CC not going to come through. Ro, 2 stacks, looking for more. There's more stacks coming in. Ro locked up. Decent damage. Revolta goes into the air. Not going to get anything else. No. Well, looks like we are going to have a bit of a brief pause here. Looks...
You good? You good?
I'm laughing because I think I just saw someone run away from the player thing. And I think it may be a player needing a bathroom break. That's my theory on the pause.
Okay, so, recap. Let's compose ourselves. We've obviously had a lot of action. We are about 12 minutes into the game. Gold advantage is heavily in favor of INTZ, largely due to the big fight that happened down in the bottom lane.
But of course, it starts sooner than that. We look back.
Oh, yeah.
We look at the Braum with red buff.
The Braum with red buff definitely did not help. But also getting the early push out for the bottom lane of the INTZ. Also, just really setting up for that early gank with the Elise, getting the kill down onto the Caitlyn. It just really set up the bottom lane for success for INTZ. And then that is what allowed them to set up the dive in the bottom lane. And then we can't really forget what happened up in the top half of the map either.
Yeah. The poppy early aggressive dives. And this is the thing. This is the risk. I love the way that Saigon Jokers play. It's so aggressive. But it's very greedy.
This is the style of play that you love, Sifa. This just mindlessly diving a Shen this early on.
I love it a little less after 50 minutes of it earlier today. But I still love aggressive play. I love these aggressive risk-taking. I think it's an interesting way to see the team play the game. They need to calculate a little more.
Yes, they definitely
do. You're not solo killing the Shen at level 3. Well, what is the value of solo killing the Shen at level 3?
Gold. 400 gold. First blood gold.
And nothing else.
But, I mean, it could have been the play that decided the game. I mean, getting Poppy ahead that early on would have been fantastic for the team. I mean, this is definitely their first time we've seen a Poppy into Shen matchup for quite a while. But early on, it definitely felt like the Poppy had the edge in terms of the trading back and forth. You could see that Shen was being forced underneath the turret. But really just so many unfortunate incidents for the side of Saigon, something that we've seen throughout this tournament where they're in the right frame of mind, but their execution just doesn't seem to be quite there.
Well, as we get back into game, we're going to have to see if the execution is going to change at all moving forward. Sue and Celebrity now on the top side. Pressure from this Shen continues to grow. 1-0-5, the score for Yang. Of course, 85-47 CS. Mid lane about evened out now with Talkers having that massive advantage. Trading back and forth here as well. Good double stun, but Revolta and Jockster are here to pressure out, knowing they have the advantage. Talker moving up. Samyon thinking he's sneaky, but he's standing right on a ward.
Now, this is the smart play to make if you're INTZ, because you've already taken the tier 1 in the bottom lane. Your AD carry and support are the best for taking down these turrets early, so you rotate them to the top half. Tempered Fate comes out.
Revolta potentially going to get chain stunned here. It looks like a lot of CC. Pop goes the spider, or up goes the spider, and down he goes in the end. The ignite ticking to burn him down. Good pickup from Saigon Jokers.
So Revolta being a little bit out of position, waiting for his duo lane to shove the minion wave underneath the turret. But Saigon, they caught him before that minion wave got there. Ended up punishing Revolta. And that's going to be another dead spider, which will get Saigon Jokers another kill on the board. Just unfortunate that Sue is the one to pick up that kill.
Oh, Talkers potentially in trouble here. Samyon running forward. They don't have any CC, but Talkers is running out of options. Warzone moving up. Don't have to use the ult in the end. Shen now on the way in. Minions ticking down. Warzone in trouble. He's getting cut through. The arrow goes wide, but the minions are still hungry. He's going to drop to Talkers in the end. Jockster following through on the Braum, but he's going to get smacked right into the wall. Ro looking his best to disengage. Winds up the hammer. Poppycopter goes boom. Out goes the rest of the team. Talkers dropping low. Team finally going to back off here.
So INTZ picked themselves up another kill after Saigon just tried to get themselves something on the board. INTZ have the numbers advantage. They're looking to siege onto this tier 1 in the mid.
Trying to find the opportunity. Ro taking a lot of poke. So much pressure into this mid lane, but Talkers is incredibly low. It looks like they will have to back off. INTZ extend their gold lead, though. 4.5k, 13 minutes in.
And Talkers, he picks himself up another kill. 4-0-1 right now. Definitely doing a great job. Going to be working towards what looks like a Rylize as his second item after picking up that needlessly large rod. But, I mean, the setup itself from Saigon was promising, because what they did was they tried to catch Talkers as he was rotating around to the top half of the map. And unfortunately, this is where you have that lack of hard crowd control to punish the fact that the Malzahar has only really his Ghost and Flash to get away. If they overcommit a little bit, they didn't respect the possibility of Shen coming in, and then Talkers realizing that once he'd baited Saigon enough, he turned around, he challenged Warzone to a scaring contest. Warzone lost, ended up getting a blueberry pie to the face, and then he ended up falling to Talkers' small companions. So INTZ still holding and further extending their gold lead.
Definitely cementing their lead even further as Saigon Jokers really have to figure out what their next move is. Drooping again once again on the top side. They've gotten one kill there before. Maybe looking to make a repeat performance. Warzone getting destroyed in these trades.
I think he's allergic to blueberries. He is certainly struggling. I mean, it makes sense. Blood Lord, really. Average appetite would be blood, so when you try and feed him blueberries, he's like, ah, no, it hurts. Now Rote, gonna be dived.
The only thing bigger than this gold lead is your commitment to this stupid blueberry thing. Oh, there he goes, Rote. Moving forward, looking for a little bit more. There goes the Malzahar ult, and that's gonna be enough damage to close it out. Rote, not gonna make it to safety. INTZ get another pick.
Easy dive for the side of INTZ, but Saigon looking to repeat.
Oh, Jockster gonna flash out. Now INTZ pushing in, looking to get another turret here on the bottom side, but the Spiderling's only tanking up a little bit. Moving in for a bit more.
So they will end up trading turrets across the map, but INTZ will get a tier 2, while Saigon only get themselves a tier 1, and have a look at what INTZ are doing on the mini-map. They're grouping up in the mid lane. They want to set up a play.
Oh, Warzone. That allergy is going to cost him so much. Alt coming in does flash out to safety.
But now INTZ, with the numbers advantage, can easily set themselves up for another turret. 16 minutes into the game, 3 turrets already down, and one of them is a tier 2. If they wanted to, they could just quickly rotate round to the dragon. They have full vision control over Saigon's bottom jungle. But Yang, he just needs to be mindful of the fact that he can't fully see where the members of Saigon are. But nevertheless, INTZ, easy Cloud Drake, should be little contention coming out from Saigon.
Spiders and Voidlings and a very dead Cloud Drake. Was a short life lived, Cloud Drake. 16 minutes into the game. I guess a long life by Dragon standards.
That is a partner party in the Dragon Pit. As Saigon now trying to respond by pushing down the mid, tier 1. Fortunately for INTZ, Mikhail had already gone back to base. Hasn't quite yet completed any major item, but Tokka's still being here should be enough to deter Saigon from committing.
Decent amount of poke here. Trying to clear out the wave. Alt onto the graves to stop the aggression, but Tokka's is in trouble, and he's set to fall. Shut down. Saigon, do not wait an instant there to get aggressive, but the rest of the team is here. Rote, maybe waiting on this hammer. Will he get the timing? He's going to knock them back, and then immediately get aggressive onto Macau. Good damage coming in. Revolta potentially in trouble. Out comes the ace in the hole. It's not going to be enough. Warzone is still on the front line. Saigon Jokers appear to be winning, but Yang leaps into the back lines. Macau is still dishing out damage. Is it going to be enough? Warzone trying to burn him down. Rote trying to take it into the fight. Rote caught out and cut down. INTZ, are they going to take control? Warzone is so low. Graves is so healthy. It's the support and the top laner versus the world. Yang is trying to 1v3 on Shen. Is he going to be able to get it? Does he have enough time? Yes. Trying to keep it together. The arrow to back him up as Macau will grab a kill. Sue making it out with his life, but the bloodbath in the mid lane.
And what started off as a terrible fight for INTZ is turned around by the fact that Yang is just so tanky. 3-0-9 now on this Shen. He was just soaking up so much of the damage, dealing with at least 3 members of Saigon, and they really had no answer to deal with it. And in all honesty, that was just such a massive misplay from Tarkas. Using his ultimate into 5 members, he thought that he would be fine. He was way too overconfident. He has not completed the Rylai's. He didn't have his summoner spells available. And even through the Shen ult, Saigon were very easily able to shut him down.
They have the Caitlyn, the Graves, so much potential burst damage. The early game barred as well. Saigon not afraid to go for those picks. The end, though. INTZ still bring it back, still managed to find the win, a 6k gold advantage.
So look at Tarkas, he just stands there, eats up so much damage for free, and at this point, it's just INTZ trying to claw something back, but we don't have time for that.
Never gonna have time for those replays, the fights continue. Revolta walking away with that blue buff, Saigon contesting every objective on the map.
Gotta be honest, would have preferred the replay over the blue buff.
but now, they don't know.
Picture it in your mind, ladies and gentlemen. Really good Bard ult, but we might get to see another one right now.
Oh, Sue looking to lock down Macau. He's potentially in trouble. Poppy ready to set it up. Macau, does he have any way out? It doesn't look like it. He is in trouble. Revolta looking to interrupt, but that's the shutdown onto the AD carry. Yang, as unkillable as ever, moves into his position on the front line. Ro is locked up, stunned up by the concussive blows. Maybe looking for a bit more, trying to buy his team time. Blueberry Pie cuts him down. The minions on the way in. They're hungry for Bard. Aren't going to find it.
And it looks like right now INTZ will come out ahead of another fight. 2-1 in their favor. Warzone was not involved in that setup whatsoever. But he is now here trying to defend this turret. And INTZ will not be able to claim that final tier 1. Notice that Yang, sitting on base waiting for a potential opportunity, sees that nothing will come of it. And now both teams will sign a gentleman's agreement and walk away. But just have a look at the goal difference between the two top laners right now.
That's gross.
Indeed.
That is the power of a 4-0 and 10. Shen Yang putting on a clinic.
He's been involved in 93%.
14 out of 15 of the kills. We just do fractions when it's hard
Damn
to
it.
Do the percentages.
Oh, man. That should be a really easy percentage, too. But nevertheless, 5-1, 2 Malzahar. 4-1, 5 Ash. Second item being completed now. There is the Rylai's. And it's just INTZ having a massive lead right now as they set up another play in the mid.
Warzone may be able to make it out. He's going to have to flash, too, if he wants to make it to safety. Nope.
Still
does
tries
flash.
To flash. But you cannot escape the blueberry buy.
Once it's on you, it's on you.
It is.
No getting out.
Well, what makes it worse is if you just add a touch of magic, it'll slow your opponents down. It fills you so much that you just feel really gluttonous, you know? It's like you're wobbling away rather than running.
0-4-4, Warzone's feeling pretty gluttonous this game. Definitely had a few too many shares of the pie as Macau pushes in on the top side of the map. And it's honestly just such a rough road for Saigon. Continuously looking for the fights, continuously looking to get aggressive. But it doesn't get easier. It only gets harder if you continue to lose fights. And unfortunately, INTZ now with an AK gold lead. They can't even kill Macau. Jocks are there to block it up. The fight's going to continue. Down is going to go the Graves. Revolta moves in. Celebrity throwing out auto after auto. But the Runan's not enough damage to keep it going. Spirit's Refuge buys a bit of time. And Talkers on the side there throwing down a little bit more damage.
Thing is now for INTZ, they have such a massive gold lead that they can just group up anywhere on the map and force any play that they want because they're pretty confident that they're going to be able to win the vast majority of these fights. They're now pushing onto this tier 2 and Saigon have no answer.
Warzone in trouble. He's going to get cut down. Every member of the team here. Nope, gets the opportunity to pull. A few members disengaged on road, leaping forward. Going to knock Macau into the wall, but the minions are there to tank it. No, he's tanking. He gets dropped in the end. Yang steps forward. Is it enough? Talk's doing so
celebrity?
Much. Oh, Celebrity caught out. Revolta Clan cleanup. Roe tries to make it into the back line, but he's not going to get it. Revolta goes up, Revolta comes down, and now the turret will fall for INTZ.
And Revolta, he doesn't even need to use his dash cannon because he comes in so late to the fight that INTZ have already set himself up to just clean things out. Saigon Jokers, they lose another turret, they lose 4 members, and now it is a 10,000 gold lead in favor of INTZ.
You know, a dominating performance coming in here. Every single member with an all-star KDA building themselves a montage. And Saigon Jokers, while the aggressive players are coming in, while they are able to find kills here and there, I think it's just too late.
INTZ almost have more kills than minutes in this game. So a little bit unfortunate. And I mean,
and we can't even say that it's INTZ playing super aggressive. It is solely Saigon Jokers running in to the meat
it's
grinder.
It's Saigon being like, they're going to battle till the very end. It doesn't matter if they're 0-5. They will fight you because they're confident. They're a believer, you know? And I like that. They do have a lot of damage with their composition. Bear that in mind. Poppy can definitely pack quite the punch. Bard definitely also hurts, especially running that Ignite. And then the Graves going for the Warriors Enchantment. But look at Sue.
No, potentially in trouble. Arrow's going to go on to Samhyun. Warzone dodges it, but just delivers it into his teammates. Good disengage coming in from the Bard ultimate. Is this the opportunity? Blueberry Pie coming in. Is going to get the fourth auto down. Jockstra having to run back. Shen ult comes in. Ro looks for the disengage. Goes wide. Not going to get it. That's so much
celebrity.
Damage on the Celebrity.
Oh, man. You know, it seems like Celebrity wants to be known, but I don't think you want to draw that much attention to yourself. That is a lot of damage coming out from the Malzahar and the Ash right now. INTZ, with all the damage they're able to get down onto their opponents, are now setting up for the Baron. And with a Malzahar, you should be able to take this pretty quickly.
Backing off. I'm going to have to get it. Can they steal this out? It doesn't look like it. It's dropping lower and lower. They're going to have to be careful. Warzone moves in. Ro is moving in. Can they steal the Baron? Not going to get it. Revolta locks it down, but Macau gets taken out. Saigon Jokers, can they win this fight? INTZ are so low. Revolta is so low. They're cutting through. Saigon Jokers are going to win the fight. INTZ are running. INTZ are getting taken down. They've overstayed their welcome. Sue, ready to move over the wall, isn't going to follow up. Good play coming in from Saigon, but still a 10K gold lead for INTZ.
So INTZ getting a little bit too big for their breeches right there. They felt like that with the gold lead, they could just easily take a Baron and reverse sweep a fight. But unfortunately for them, they did not respect the fact that Warzone could get a multi-man ultimate off. The Baron reduces your magic resistance, and it really made it so easy for Saigon to just sit on the outside of the fight and clean up the rest of INTZ. And note that Ro, he had little to no contention as he dived onto McCann. Cow cleaned up the AD carry of INTZ, and honestly, with him gone, it made it so easy for Saigon to clean up the rest of the fight. So, honestly, very well played fight. Saigon will get a little bit of gold on the board, but there are still two members of INTZ with that Baron, which will definitely make things worse moving forward.
Oh, Yang is going to kill someone. We're going to go into this replay. Never mind. Out of the replay. Now we're fighting on the top side as Yang looks to take down Warzone. He's in a good spot to do it. Warzone, I don't think, has the cooldowns to keep this fight going. Is going to get the pool out. Will he be able to get the butt? No. Moving forward, Macau over the wall. He's going to get the kill in the end. But while things are looking grim, Celebrity has been farming up. He mentioned, now going to find the opportunity to fight. It's never going to stop. Talker's potentially in trouble. Arrow comes over, hits the Graves, looking for the disengage on Poppy. Canceled out in the end.
Look at the turret. One more hit will secure it for INTZ. Saigon not quite able to find themselves a fight, but good disengage arrow coming out from Macau mitigates a lot of the damage that they had available. With Warzone gone, INTZ feel confident enough to keep pushing and look at how much damage Celebrity has taken under the turret.
Oh, this double stun comes in. That's a lot of burst. Going up, making sure the Shen is going to get delivered here. Yang comes in full health. Celebrity consistently on the front lines. Does have the two items. Does make it out with his life.
That was close. That was very, very, very close. Fortunately, though, for Saigon, they are not going to lose their AD carry, and they're not really going to lose much more. A bit of damage onto that tier 3 in the mid, but other than that, they will get away. Gold lead maintaining at about 10,000. But now for INTZ, they need to try and take advantage of this Baron, which is starting to run out. Should be able to find out relatively soon how much time they have left on it, but I don't think there is very much. Well, they have about a minute and a half left, which means that they can put Talkers with four members of INTZ, send Yang to the other side lane, and then you pretty much have two powerful pushing lanes. Make sure that you already have the bottom lane, which is pushing in your favor, and then you can really start to set up a really good 1-4 split push, which honestly, Saigon should really have no answer for. Their wave clear is okay. They have a trap line to delay INTZ. But with the Baron buff, with the gold advantage, honestly, it wouldn't be very difficult for INTZ to just set themselves up a dive.
INTZ, it's 27 minutes in and they have a 10k gold lead. They are in a great spot. Now moving into control of the jungle, but Saigon Jokers are determined to contest them at each and every corner, so it's making INTZ play a little bit more cautious.
Just keep your eyes on the Ashe. Actually sitting in the mid lane, nowhere near her team. This is not a great setup for INTZ. They're really wasting this Baron, because to break into the base will not be easy. And honestly, just Saigon can just keep buying time, because as we talked about earlier, they have the traps. They still have a relatively decent late game. And based on what we've seen today, if you're not able to close games out quickly, that late game can definitely be a turning point.
And there's no Gangplank this time, but the Vlad will scale up. Caitlyn as well, a terrifying threat as you move further into the game. The trap line that you mentioned, delaying the siege as Yang pressures in on the top side.
Honestly, just the setup for INTZ is really the misplay that is making their lives difficult right now, because they're not aligning the waves. They're not pushing at the same time. They're just rotating around, and then Saigon can just match them. Meanwhile, Ro is holding his own in the top lane. Three-level disadvantage, but it doesn't matter because he's just there for wave clear duty anyway. INTZ had an opportunity to break into the base. They did not take advantage of it, and now it's pretty much just going to be them, honestly, just farming, because they have no easy way to set up a siege onto these turrets.
Good spot for Saigon to be. Tempering their aggression as well, or not. They may look to get aggressive here, knocking Yang into the wall, maybe looking for a bit of a fight, but INTZ are just going to move in and take this tower in response. Bardolt comes out. Macau just going to sidestep. Fight keeps going. Warzone moving forward. That's a lot of damage. Sue looking for the stun. Blocked out by the Bard, or the Braum, rather, moving in. Waiting to turn it. Warzone set to fall. That's so much damage. Will he make it out? Roe is on the front lines. He's going to be able to get one. Caitlyn grabs the kill. Celebrity tries to make it out. He is still alive. Macau on the front lines to dish it out. He gets a double of his own. Roe trying to knock him back into the team. But Yang is absolutely unkillable. And INTZ make it a 4-for-1 trade in the end.
The worst thing Saigon could have done is tried to force a fight. They thought that they'd caught Yang out of position. But even if you had, why would you want to engage onto this 5-0? 18 Shen, INTZ, they have a minion wave, they have the gold lead, they may look to try and close out this game.
Steadily closing down those towers, will they overextend? It's Celebrity and Sue, the only members left standing. They're just going to take one out and immediately back off. Every time,
Saigon, I admire your consistency, but sometimes you need to just take your foot off the pedal, you know? They're a little bit bloodthirsty. Unfortunately for them, it will cost them an inhibitor. And note now, Baron, going to be spawning in about 1 minute's time. INTZ, they have a minion wave constantly pushing in the top half of the map. Send your Shen to the bottom lane. Get mid lane priority. Get a bit of deep vision around the top half of Saigon Joker's jungle. Rotate round to the Baron. You have the Mals, you have the Ashe, and the Elise. Very easy pickup. And then you should be able to, with the Baron, close out this game.
Yeah, should be slow. Or steady, systematic close coming from INTZ, although Saigon Jokers, if they look for one more fight, actually will be their own undoing there.
Yes.
That's the sad state of affairs. They need to wait. They need to pull back. This gold lead is too massive. It's almost insurmountable.
So here we are. Look, you can see INTZ pushing up the mid lane. They've already got a bit of vision down. They want to extend this vision a little bit more. Just so that they can see, here we are. You've also got the entrances warded up from INTZ. Now the moment the Baron spawns, they can just rush it down. Shen is in the bottom lane. He has his ultimate. He has the TP. Because of this deep vision, he can also flank in with the TP if he wants to. But Saigon are doing a good job of responding by clearing out some of these waves.
Oh, Ro. Moving forward, Revolta potentially caught out. Shen ulti coming in to save him. Saigon Joker's getting aggressive. Macau is locked up. A brief window here, but Yang is unkillable. He's on the front line. He already has a Thorn Mail. Warzone into the back line. Talker's slowly burning down. Ace in the hole coming out. Saigon Joker's moving forward, but they're losing the fight, and they continue to advance anyway. Absolutely fearless in the face of defeat. Sue looking for the stun. Celebrity trying to get out some damage, but not a single member of INTZ has fallen just yet. Celebrity hoping to get a kill. Is he going to get Jockster? No. But he will drop in the end. That is a 5-for-0 exchange, a triple kill coming in for INTZ, and I am stunned as Saigon Jokers look for a final fight, but it'll win INTZ the game.
You called it, Sifa. The worst thing that Saigon could have done is tried to force a fight. They do it anyway. They stick to their bad habits, and this will result in INTZ closing out the game and securing a top 4 spot.
And down go the dreams of the Chiefs fans and the supporters of Saigon Jokers, but a good win coming in from INTZ. Calm, collected, systematic, and above all, bloody.
Oh yeah. 31 kills to 11.
I've cast more kills today than I have in my entire casting career up to this moment.
Welcome to Wildcard. And we still got another day tomorrow.
Oh, it's gonna be great.
Assuming you wake up, because I imagine you're going to need a rest. But INTZ, they can rest up now knowing that they have secured themselves a top 4 spot. What they're now playing for is actually... I believe that they are done. No, one more game. I'm going to have to find... Yeah, one more game tomorrow. So they will be playing for seeding moving forward. Which is still very important, because if we look at the performance the Lions have had, nobody really wants to be sitting in that fourth seed spot.
Looking, of course, forward, top 4 contention absolutely matters as INTZ find this win. Very important for the team overall. No, they're 5-2. They're done. That is my mistake.
They are 5-2. So there we are. They are
ending 5-2. You can see on your screen some of the premier moments of this game. I mean, there's not a lot to say. There's a lot. I mean, there's a lot of team fights. They're constant. They're nonstop. But this isn't like...
I mean, you have to praise Saigon, though, sticking to their guns, just constantly looking for fights whenever they saw an opportunity. Definitely did not work out, was not an effective strategy, but it was extremely entertaining. And, I mean, the story for Saigon throughout this tournament is, honestly, early on, they looked very close in multiple games that they just lost out on. And if they'd just been a little bit more reserved in their play, they could have been a top contender. But honestly, like, they've always had the right mentality. They've always had the right idea in mind. But then when it comes to execution, they just seem to fall apart. And this is one of those fights where they were able to get themselves a slight advantage, but the gold gap was already so big that honestly, it was just way too difficult for them to claw any way back in.
And maybe if they had gotten the Baron as well, it would have been a different story. Maybe if they had taken their foot off the pedal once or twice, they may have been able to come back. But
maybe if they hadn't eaten so many blueberry pies early on.
Maybe if you stopped saying that. Who knows? The world would be a different place, Fedius. Of course, we have to see. You can see now why this team is so dominant in their region, though, because you can imagine how this aggressive play style works when they do get a lead.
Oh, yeah.
When they are able to find advantages, because that would be absolutely overwhelming. But INTZ, they play around it well. They respect it. And really just works out quite well. The Braum coming in was a crucial pick to shut this down.
And Yang, I mean, really needs to be the player that we talk about for the side of INTZ. 5-0-18. Likely going to be picking up a couple more assists in these final few team fights, but honestly, he was just a consistent performer throughout, getting some fantastic taunts down, acting as a reliable front line, winning out what could have been a horrible team fight for INTZ in the mid game, and swinging it in their favor. Just consistently performing, honestly, throughout this tournament, and has been a staple leader, and honestly, big reason as to their success.
Aside from Revolta, I would argue that Yang is the best player on this team.
I think Yang. Well, he and Macau could contest that, but
and Revolta.
Meh,
not a fan of Revolta.
No, I honestly feel like he's a little bit inconsistent. He's too over aggressive. He's not fully aware of his positioning on the map. He gets caught out a little bit too often.
Okay, all right. We can agree on Yang.
We can agree on Yang.
We can agree on Yang. Yang, I mean, showing us a monster performance on that Gnar as well as a final performance here on the Shen. Beautiful way to end the regular stage of the group stage. They are now 5-2. They have secured themselves a spot. Which spot we will have to find out as we move forward in the tournament. But
yes, because there's a lot of complicated head-to-head records, and the other teams can still go 5-2. Albus will play Lion tomorrow, which is definitely an important game. But we can talk about that a little later because we need to concentrate on the performers. Macau was given the MVP of that game. Still a very solid performance on the Ashe. A large part of why they were able to get the win out was because of the setup that they had in the bottom lane. Going for the early level 2, getting that early push, and then setting themselves up for that dive, which really started to snowball that gold lead, is where a lot of this game's lead originated.
And I
from.
Think you could argue for a lot of the different players on this team.
Yeah,
it was
certainly
an all-star performance across the board. I mean, really, it looked good. It looked good in just about every single lane. Yeah. Malzahar versus Vladimir, the only kind of rougher spot in the early game. But I think overall, a solid performance from INTZ. I think you very clearly displayed that they were the superior team here, that they knew exactly how to out-execute. And it's clear from what Saigon Jokers have brought to this tournament that they simply were not prepared. And that's okay. Maybe they'll get another shot in the future. They were dominant in their region. I expect that they may continue to be able to be dominant in their region. But
yep. Honestly, they just... I think that they were very slow to adapt to the meta early on. Their pick and ban phase was something that we critiqued very heavily. And then once they did start to pick slightly more meta picks and seem to be a little bit more aware of what they should be doing on the map, it was very much about this execution thing that we've been consistently talking about throughout the tournament, where they have the right idea. Hey, we should move up to this tower. Hey, we should contest this objection. But unfortunately, they just they messed up. They couldn't properly execute.
At the end of the day, when we look across the team for INTZ as well, it's been a good run for them. We were very critical of them at the start when they dropped their first few losses because Brazil is a region that we always have the highest expectations for. However, they've shown up 5-2. They're moving into semifinals, and now the question becomes, can they clinch it? Can they maintain this level of performance? The truth is, I don't think that we can really say for sure that this INTZ performance is an indicator of what we can expect in the future.
That's the interesting thing. We'll have to see how they do moving forward because they will be in the semifinals. It will be a best of 5, which is a completely different environment because you're going to have to adapt. You're going to have to bring out all kinds of unique and different strategies, and you're just going to have to be able to play on the fly because of how flexible you need to be. But moving forward, INTZ now sitting at 5-2. Underneath them is Dark Passage and Albus Nox. Both of them play tomorrow. And I believe Dark Passage are going up against Saigon Jokers, which, based on their performance, we could argue that they are likely going to win. And then we know that Albus Nox are going up against Lion. Now, That one will be a very interesting matchup, because if Albus Knox lose, that will actually put them at 4-3. And even if the Chiefs win, Albus Knox will have the head-to-head record, which will guarantee them, obviously, that fourth place spot. But that will result in Albus Knox being in fourth seed and Dark Passage and INTZ being the 2-3 seeds going up against one another, which, you know, looking at the schedule, I mean, it's a little bit surprising, because a lot of us thought that Albus Knox would be that second place team, would be the team sitting at the top.
I honestly thought that they would be the first place team coming into this tournament, but Lion has been a consistent surprise. Now, I want to talk a little bit about that matchup coming in tomorrow, because Lion, I think Lion Albus Knox safely is our most hype matchup moving forward. Well, of course, the tiebreaker standings and the implications of every match are going to be crucial tomorrow, but looking at that matchup in particular, I've just got to wonder, who do you think is going to come out on top?
I feel that Lion are the stronger team coming in. Lion, so far, are on an undefeated record ever since qualifying. They were on a 14-0 coming into the international qualifier. They have now maintained that, being 6-0. There was a lot of doubt, because a lot of Latin American North teams have not been performing on the international stage.
And specifically, Lion Gaming was that team that was not performing when we saw them at IWCI. They only found a single win. So this change is huge.
It's incredible. I mean, a lot of that we have to give to Oddie in the jungle, picking up Say It in the mid lane. I mean, they've just had these very small changes, which have just resulted in huge performance increases for the team. And I've thoroughly enjoyed watching them play. I'm looking forward to seeing how they also do in a best of five scenario, because obviously it is a different ball game. You don't get that potential of, oh, we had a good game, we had a good start. Teams will be able to adapt. Teams will be able to react. But it's exciting to see the promise from this team. And honestly, I'm quite excited to see how they could do on a world stage.
I think very interesting. I think they have to still have to make it through that best of five, and we have to wonder how their mental fortitude will hold up. It's not something we always want to talk about, but keep in mind, when a team has been winning this much, what happens? How do they react to a loss? How do you think that they're going to come into that? Because to me, it seems like we know from Albus Knox that they're a team that's experienced loss. They've been able to qualify before. They've been able to put on some impressive performances in the past. You know, under a different name, of course, is Hard Random. So they have the experience necessary here, I feel, regardless of if Lion can get an early game. And for me, I think that if Lion lose a game, we could see an entirely different shade of this team.
Yeah, that's entirely it. I'm really looking forward. I wonder if we're going to see the brand come out again tomorrow as well. But I do think that the mid lane matchup in particular will be quite important, because both Seiya and Kira have received a huge amount of praise. And I think that depending on who gets the winning matchup could actually be a big swinging factor into how they do. But then something that we've seen a lot from both these teams is that mid-jungle synergy. You know, how much attention they've actually been setting up for their mid laner and enabling them to roam around the map and set up those plays. So I'm quite excited to see that mid-jungle do and how well they perform.
Well, and I think it's excellent that you pointed out, because when we look at the mid lane matchup, Seiya, formerly an AD carry, now all-star mid laner for this team, versus Kira, you know, the 1v1 god that we saw coming in from IWCA. I think, we have two very star-studded lineups here, and especially focusing in the mid lane, like, this is where the attention is going to go. This is where the fan focus is going to go. And there's a lot of pressure on these guys to come out on top, because when we look at the picks coming in, I mean, Vladimir, Malzahar, we've seen these picks both be defining. Talia, we see a lot of bans moving forward. The Cassio, these guys have very interesting champion pools, and there's a lot of this damage potential coming in the mid lane in the current meta.
Yeah, I'm quite excited to see the potential of a Cassiopeia as well, because I think that she has been a rising popularity throughout the world. Syndra as well, we've seen over in the North American and European finals. And honestly, the mid lane meta is so exciting right now. And given that we have such talented mid laners going up in the international wildcard, I think it'll be an exciting matchup tomorrow.
But of course, speaking of that, we got to turn our focus back to INTZ to send it over to Hangers, who's standing by for an interview.
Thanks very much. I'm now joined by Revolta Jungler for the Victoria's Ints, or INTZ. How are you feeling? You guys have just qualified for semifinals.
I'm feeling great, actually, because we were not playing our best in the last, like, 2 days. And yesterday we had a big talk about what we were going to do and what we were doing. And it really fixed all of our problems, I guess. And today, it was really good to beat Albus Knox, because they beat us last time, so we feel really good now.
I mean, is it kind of bittersweet, though, because it came down to either you guys or the Chiefs making semifinals? And I know you guys are friends and you get along quite well. So, like, does that even play into your mind when you're in the game, or is it just like, no, we're going to win, this is for us?
Oh, we play for win, but We feel really sad for Chiefs because we're really friends with them, and since the first wild card, we hang out together when we meet each other. When I went to Australia and for All-Stars, we also met each other, and it was really good. Yeah. So, I mean, we just like them a lot.
Sure. So moving forward now, we've still got to work out what the placings are in the semifinals, but you guys are back in form. You're playing well. Do you feel confident that you guys can take it to Worlds?
I think we have a really good chance to make it to Worlds. However, I think we need to study Lion, especially if we get to face them into semifinals, because they're the big surprise of this tournament, and sure, nobody expected them to be so good. So if we face them, we have to do a big, big study onto them.
And finally, do you have any message for the English language fans of INTZ who might be watching right now? You want to say anything to them?
I want to say that it doesn't matter if you're like you speak English or Portuguese or Turkish. If you cheer for us, thank you very much. I know sometimes we do like silly stuff and we lose games that we shouldn't lose, but you know, your support is really appreciated and it helps us to get the right motivation to come back and win again.
Well, thank you so much for talking to us. Congratulations on the win, and that's all from us. I'll send it back to you guys at the desk.
And no matter language, color, or creed, Revolta happy to have that support. I can't blame him. Be good to have that fan support overall, and good to hear that he's feeling good coming in, and confirms our suspicions that no one expected the Lion to do this well, but I want to bring it back. Of course, we have now finished our final game in Day 5. This gives us an excellent opportunity to look at the results thus far.
Yeah, a bit of a surprise.